Now let's start with another important term to be considered about chemical reaction. That's the order of the reaction. The order of the reaction. What is the order of a chemical reaction? For a chemical reaction, the order is the summation of the powers of the concentrations present in the rate law. So we need to calculate the rate law, and then to calculate the order of the reaction, we would sum m plus n. In this case, we would have, in some cases, we would have zero order reaction, we would have a first order reaction, we would have a second and a third order reactions. Okay, so to calculate the order of the reaction, it's very easy by adding the two values of the powers of concentration as seen in the rate law. The value produced is the order of the reaction. So that we can check in different equations like this one. This reaction is having one reactant, only one reactant, that's the dinitrogen pentoxide. It is a second order reaction. If we refer to the reaction of production of ammonia, of production of nitrogen gas by the reaction of ammonium ions and nitrite ions, we will see that the reaction is first order in ammonia and first order in nitrite, and the overall is a second order reaction. يبقى احنا نقدر نقول انه الرياكشن بتاعنا الاوردر بتاعه بيختلف حسب الرياكتانتس. We are not dealing with the products. Order is relative to reactants, but not two products. In this reaction, the reactant is only one reactant, that's dinitrogen pentoxide. This reaction is a second order reaction. It's a second order for dinitrogen pentoxide. يعني dinitrogen pentoxide هو نفسه second order للرياكشن دوت لأنه قدامه اتنين, والoverall order is also a second order. طيب وعندنا الرياكشن التاني اللي خدناه قبل كده اللي هو production أو synthesis of nitrogen gas عن طريق تفاعل الأمونيوم ions والنيترايت ions. الأمونيوم ions قدامه رقم واحد بس في الرياكشن, فحنقول إنه the reaction is first order in ammonium. والنيترايد برضو قدامه واحد بس في البالانسد ايكويشن, فهنقدر نقول انه it's a first order in nitrite. طيب بالنسبة للoverall order هتساوي الواحد اللي موجودة جنب الامونيوم والواحد اللي موجودة جنب النيترايد, يبقى اتنين, يبقى الoverall order is a second order reaction. يبقى كل reactant بيبقى له الorder المنفصل بتاعه, والoverall reaction ليه order هو مجموعهم مع بعض. We are saying that each reaction has two types of orders. It has order for each reactant. Each reactant has an order equal to the number of moles appearing in the equation. And we are having an overall order, that's the summation of the orders of all reactants involved in the reaction. We are still talking about the reaction of ammonium ions and nitrite ions to produce nitrogen gas. You remember this time this table, we have worked on the values present in this table in the previous lecture. Now we are using one of these values to calculate the rate constant, okay? The rate law for this equation would be like this. The rate is equal to the rate constant multiplied by the active mass of ammonium multiplied by the active mass of nitrite. Here the active mass is the molar concentration raised to power 1. And here the active mass is the molar concentration raised to power 1. In this reaction, as we have mentioned in the previous slide, it's a first order in ammonium. It's also a first order in nitrite, and it's a second order overall. We can calculate the K value by using any of these pairs. We use a pair value of the concentration of ammonium and nitrite. And knowing the initial rate, the value of the initial rate, so we can get K value like in here. We use the experiment one. The rate is equal to 5.4 times 10 to the power minus 7 meter per, mole per second, while the concentrations of the reactants is 0.001 for ammonium and 0.2 for nitrite. The only unknown value here would be K, the rate constant, so we can easily calculate the K value and state it as a fixed or constant value for this reaction. So, if the reaction is a first order in a reactant, in this case, if the concentration of this reactant is doubled, the rate doubles. And if the concentration triples, the rate triples. Okay, this if we are talking about A. If we are talking about B and the reaction is a second order with respect to a component, if the rate is, if the concentration is doubled, doubling the concentration results in increasing the rate by a factor of 4. And tripling the concentration would result in increasing the rate by a factor of 9. It's 3 raised to the power 2. 2 is the order, and 3 is the increase in concentration. What about if the reaction is 0 order? What about if the reaction is a zero-order reaction? What does it mean to be a zero-order reaction? It means to compared with respect to one of the reactants, it means that this reactant has no effect on the rate. Increasing the concentration of this reactant does not affect the rate, does not cause the rate to increase. So a zero-order reaction with respect to a component means that the reactant has no effect on rate. If the concentration of the reactant increases, rate is not changed. Let's talk about example of zero order reactions. Zero-order reactions are independent on the concentration of the reacting substances. Whatever the concentration of the reactant substance increases, the rate is not affected at all. What type of reactions that can show a zero-order reaction? The example we are going to study are the reactions that need a surface or a catalyst to be performed. When this surface is catalyzed by the reactant, the reaction is converted to a zero order reaction. Let's take an example to discuss this issue. The decomposition, the thermal decomposition of dinitrogen, of the nitrous oxide gas, requires the presence of hot platinum surface. Hot platinum surface as a catalyst to be converted to nitrogen gas and oxygen gas. Let's assume that this is the surface of platinum, the hot platinum surface. The reactant is the nitrous oxide. This is the container containing the nitrous oxide. Nitrous oxide is attached on the surface of the platinum. What happens when the surface of the platinum is totally saturated with the nitrous oxide, like this form? There is no place. In this case, platinum is saturated, platinum surface is totally saturated, there is no place for more nitrous oxide molecules. These are the nitrous oxide molecules. However, we increase the concentration of nitrous oxide inside the container, the reaction rate is not affected, because the reaction rate needs only the molecules present on the surface of the platinum. Only the molecules present on the platinum surface are going to react. However, we increase the concentration of nitrous oxide, nothing is changing, the rate is not changing, so this reaction is a zero order. So, let's state one more time, zero order reactions involve a reactant that does not affect the rate of the chemical reaction. This happens when the reactant, when the reaction involves the presence or the need of a surface or a catalyst for the reaction to take place. When this surface or catalyst is saturated by the reactants, the reaction is converted to a zero order. What about first order reactions? These are reactions that contain only one molecule or only one reactant that affects the rate of this reaction. We have some examples here. First is the thermal decomposition of dinitrogen pentoxide. Only one molecule of dinitrogen pentoxide is required. Hydrolysis of hydrogen peroxide or decomposition of hydrogen peroxide into water and oxygen. Only one molecule here is needed. The decomposition of calcium carbonate into calcium oxide and carbon dioxide, and only one molecule of calcium carbonate is needed. Another exceptional case of reaction orders is the pseudo-order reactions. Pseudo-order reactions. Pseudo-order reactions are mostly first-order reactions that contains one of the reactants present in excess. It's a reaction that contains two components or two reactants, but one of them is present in excess, and it's mostly the solvent. Of course, when we're adding a solvent to a system or to a reaction, it's added in excess, like when we add water. Like when we add water to a reaction, and it's the solvent, and in the same time, it's one of the reactants. Like in the hydrolysis of esters. Like in the hydrolysis of esters, we use excess water. So in this case, water concentration is not being in excess. Being in excess does not affect the rate of the chemical reaction. It acts as a solvent as it's present in excess. The rate of the reaction is only affected by the concentration of ester. Why this reaction is called a pseudo order? Because the experimental order is different from the actual one observed. In this reaction, the experimental order is 2-1 and the second, so it's a second order experimentally, but actually it's a pseudo first order because only one reactant is affecting the rate of this reaction. So the famous example for pseudo order reactions is the acid hydrolysis of esters. Any reaction that involves hydrolysis, the presence of water, water is always present in excess. So this means that this reaction is a pseudo order reaction. أي reaction هيبقى فيه water يا جماعة in excess يبقى ده pseudo order reaction. Finally, the second order reactions. لما يبقى الرياكشن فيه two reactants, two reactants are involved, or two molecules of reactants are involved, either it's one compound or two compounds. Okay, here the rate law for the first equation is involved with the active mass of A raised to the power 2, so N is 2 and the order is 2, or when there are two reactants, and the order is the overall powers here, 1 plus 1 is equal to 2. Examples for second order reactions is the thermal decomposition of nitrous oxide. We have two molecules of nitrous oxide undergoing this reaction. The decomposition of nitrogen dioxide is also a second order, and the decomposition of hydrogen is iodide
enhanced or increased.
Another factor that we have previously mentioned as one of the factors affecting the rate of chemical reaction is the use of catalysts, or the process called catalysis. Catalysis is the process of using a catalyst. A catalyst is a chemical substance that changes the rate of chemical reaction, but itself not chemically changed at the end of the reaction. It enhances the rate, but not changed itself. Not changed itself at the end of the reaction. It remains the same concerning concentration or structure. Its chemical structure remains the same. Its concentration remains the same. Catalysts increase the rate of chemical reaction by decreasing the activation energy of the reaction. الفاليو بتاعت الاكتيفيشن انرجي اللي شفناها اللي لازم المولكيولز توصل لها عشان تبتدي رياكشن الكاتاليست بيقللها فبيبقى سهل ان عدد كبير من المولكيولز تعدي الاكتيفيشن انرجي وتقوم برياكشن. As the catalyst decreases the activation energy, so a larger number of molecules can pass the activation energy barrier, and thus the reaction rate is increasing. Catalysis is divided into two main categories. The first is the homogeneous catalysis, and as the name indicates, the catalyst and the reaction medium are of the same phase. They are all liquids, or they are all gases. They are mostly or liquids. Examples of homogeneous catalysis is the acid catalysis using acid as a catalyst, organometallic catalysis, and enzymatic catalysis, the use of enzymes as catalysts. Homogeneous catalysis involves mostly the introduction of an aqueous phase catalyst into aqueous solution reactants. In most cases, the reaction is aqueous, and I'm introducing an aqueous solution of the catalyst. So acids and bases more often act as effective catalysts because they are prepared in aqueous solution and can act as catalysts for any reaction taking place in aqueous medium. Homogeneous catalysis is more effective because the catalyst easily mixes into the reaction mixture, allows a very high degree of interaction between the catalyst and the reactant molecules, and thus the reaction rate is easily enhanced. But the major disadvantage is that the homogeneous catalyst is not easily separated after the reaction ends. When the reaction ends, you cannot separate the catalyst from the mixture. Catalyst cannot be separated or recovered. An example of acid hydrolysis, as an example of homogeneous catalysis, is the acid hydrolysis of esters. Methyl acetate ester is hydrolyzed by the presence of acid in the aqueous medium into the corresponding alcohol and carboxylic acid, methanol and acetic acid, by heating under reflux with dilute acid, like dilute hydrochloric or dilute sulfuric acid. In this case, the reactant, the catalyst, and the products are all liquid, the same phase, and this is an example of homogeneous catalysis. When I'm saying homogeneous, I'm talking about the catalyst and the reactants. So when you find the catalyst in aqueous medium, this means it's homogeneous with the reactant molecules, and this is an example of homogeneous catalysis. The second type is the heterogeneous catalysis. It happens when the catalyst is mostly solid and added to a liquid medium or an aqueous medium. The use of heterogeneous catalysts have been previously discussed when we talked about zero-order reactions. In zero-order reactions, we talked about that a reactant is not affecting the rate when the surface of the catalyst is totally saturated. So for molecules to get adsorbed on the surface of the catalyst, this means that the catalyst is solid. The catalyst must be solid in a liquid medium. The reaction medium or the reactants are liquid or aqueous solutions. In this case, this is example of heterogeneous catalysis and example of zero-order reactions. يبقى احنا كده عندنا لما نتكلم على الكاتاليست بتاعي يكون عبارة عن solid والreactants يكونوا liquids أو aqueous solutions, يبقى ده example للheterogeneous catalysis وexample للzero-order reactions. لأننا لما اتكلمنا على zero-order reactions قلنا إنه reaction بيحصل أو الرياكتنت بيبقى not affecting the rate لما يبقى السيرفس بتاع الانزيم saturated أو الكاتاليست أسفة saturated. فعشان يبقى فيه سيرفس الموليكيولز تبقى attached عليه لازم يبقى solid. يبقى الكلام ده ما بيحصلش الزيرو أوردر كاتاليسز أو الزيرو أوردر رياكشنز ما بيحصلش غير في حالة السوليد كاتاليستس. السوليد كاتاليستس. أوكي؟ So we can sum up the characteristics of catalytic reactions. Catalysts remain unchanged in mass and chemical composition. Only a small quantity is generally needed to perform the reaction. They are more effective when finely divided, like in the form of powder or in homogeneous solution. It's very specific, which means that a catalyst is needed for a certain reaction. It does not affect the equilibrium position. The equilibrium remains constant, and it depends on temperature. Temperature also affects the action of a catalyst. One of the specific cases of using a catalyst is the autocatalysis. This happens when one of the products of the reaction acts as a catalyst for the same reaction, like the oxidation of oxalic acid with potassium permanganate in acid medium to produce potassium sulfate, water, carbon dioxide, and manganese sulfate. In this case, the manganese ion present in manganese sulfate act as autocatalyst, which catalyzes the same reaction. It's a product of the reaction that catalyzes more of the reaction to proceed. As we are talking about catalysts, we must give a hint about enzymes. Enzymes are the biocatalysts. They are the catalysts acting in biological systems or biological media. Enzymes react with the substrate. They bind together in a Kellogg model to form the enzyme substrate complex. This binding is always called the Kellogg model, as they are complementary to each other. This complex enhances the rate of the reaction intended, and then they separate. The enzyme remains unchanged, of course, in concentration and in structure, and the products are formed. Characteristics of enzymatic catalysis is very similar to regular catalysts, but with more specific criteria. They are the most efficient catalysts known. They are marked by absolute specificity. Every reaction has its own enzyme. Maximum activity appears at optimum temperature, it means it needs an optimum temperature to act at, it needs optimum pH to act at. The optimum temperature is mostly 37 degrees centigrade. That's the normal biological temperature of the body. They are greatly affected by inhibitors. Some chemical substances act as inhibitors to an enzyme. And they are greatly enhanced by activators or coenzymes. Examples of enzymatic reactions, like the fermentation taking place by yeast in the presence of enzyme zymase, the breakdown of starch into maltose by the enzyme diastase, the breakdown of starch into unisaccharides or sugars in the mouth by the salivary amylase. The last part, or the last topic to be discussed, is the molecularity. What is the molecularity? It's the number of ions or atoms or molecules involved in the reaction, involved in the rate determining step, or in the rate limiting step. عدد المولكيولز اللي موجود في الإكويشن. بنعد المولكيولز اللي موجودة في الإكويشن. This is called the molecularity. So to differentiate between molecularity and order, molecularity is calculated from the equation itself, the balanced chemical equation, while the order is calculated from the rate law. Molecularity can be a whole number, an integer, not a fraction, and not a zero. It cannot be a zero or a fraction. A reaction can be unimolecular, bimolecular, termolecular, according to the number of molecules. Let's check these examples. In this reaction, here is only one molecule, so it's a unimolecular. There is two molecules, it's bimolecular. Two different molecules, also bimolecular. Three molecules of the same reactant, it's a termolecular. Three molecules of two reactants, it's a termolecular, and the three different molecules is also a termolecular. In some cases, order is equal to molecularity, like in examples 1, 2, 3, and 4. Order is similar in this case to molecularity. Its order is equal to 1, and molecularity is also equal to 1. In this case, order is equal to 2 and molecularity is equal to 2. The difference takes place in these examples, example 5 and 6. In example 5, this is the reaction of hydrolysis of acid chlorides to be converted into alcohols and hydrochloric acids. It's a hydrolysis reaction. And in hydrolysis reaction, we have previously said it's a pseudo first order. So the order is a first order. Molecularity is 1 plus 1 equal 2. Another example is the hydrolysis of esters. Reaction with water is a hydrolysis. So water is present in excess. So it's a pseudo order reaction. So the order is a first order. Molecularity is 2. So these cases are exceptional cases when molecularity is not equal to order. Examples 5 and 6. So this is a summation for the differences between the molecularity and order. A molecularity is the number of reacting species undergoing the collisions in the reaction, while the order is the sum of the powers of the concentration terms in the rate law expression or the rate law equation. Molecularity is a theoretical concept. It's not the actual thing taking place in the reaction, while the order is the experimental value, like in the pseudo-order reactions. Molecularity is always a whole number, cannot be a zero. The order sometimes can be fractional value and can be a zero. Molecularity does not tell us anything about the mechanism of the reaction. It says that one molecule reacts with one molecule to give a product, but order gives some idea or some clue about the mechanism of the reaction. Like in pseudo-order reactions, it tells us that one of the reactants is present in excess. It does not affect the rate, while the second is the rate-determining reactant or the rate-determining ingredient in this reaction. Dear all, I'm so thankful to you for being with us this semester. I hope you all pass our course and go successfully to analytical chemistry too. Please study well. I hope we can make a live meeting next week to discuss any questions or any concerns from your side about the course. We will set a time. I will announce it on the Teams, and I hope you will be there. شكرا يا شباب على اهتمامكم بالمحاضرات. نذاكر كويس ونشد حيلنا. ان شاء الله الاسبوع الجاي هنحاول نحدد ميعاد للايف ميتنج. لو تحبوا تسألوا على اي حاجة هنحدد الميعاد على التيم، وبرضو نزلوا اسئلتكم اللي انتوا تحبوها كلها على